This is Pastor Aubrey, the senior pastor of Race for Purpose Ministries, popularly abbreviated as RFP. I want to specially invite you to be a part of this that God is doing in this end time, to be part of the army, to be part of the strategy of God in this end times. You can be a part of us by attending our weekly services, our weekly programs. You can be streaming our services live, or you can be listening to them at any time. We are on different platforms. We are on YouTube, we are on Facebook, we are on Mixer, and many other platforms. Some of the details are those that are showing on the screen. We are physically in almost every district in Malawi, and even outside Malawi. You can get in touch with us, and we'll let you know where RFP is. You know, RFP is home, and is home for you and home for me. Be a part of what God is doing. I'll be looking forward to seeing you. God bless you. I would like to welcome all of you to this second service. This first service was with Pastor Emma, and I streamed it. Wonderful service. He's a God of all, she said. And in this service, the second one, we will continue from there. And as I say, every time that you come to these services, look at them as services of healings, services of miracles, services of impartation, services of encounters. In short, it's a service to trust the Lord to do great, mighty, and notable things in your life. Things that no man can do. Things that your hard work cannot do. Things that your connections cannot do. Things that only God can do. And then to also, you know, to also encounter Him. And I've always told you that encounters do so much. There is so much that an encounter, one encounter, a single encounter, can achieve so much in your life, not only for your today, but for many years to come. An encounter can transform you not for today only, but for many years to come. It took one single encounter that so hard on the road to Damascus. That encounter is still speaking up to today. We are reading the letters of Paul today just because of one major encounter. Yes, many other encounters followed, but that was the start. That first encounter changed everything. Because with that encounter, the Bible tells us that the light shined. That light chased out all the darkness, changed everything. And that light has kept shining even after his death. That light that Paul that Saul encountered, Saul that became Paul, what he encountered is still speaking today. Hallelujah. So trust the Lord for encounters. Don't only be buried in the challenges, situations you have, the petitions you have that, Lord, I want this to change. I want this to happen. Don't just be buried in that. That's one of it. But the other part, trust the Lord that you're going to encounter Him in a special way. And I always like to call for testimonies at the end of the service. Make sure you let us know what the Lord has done. You know, I told you that your testimony is a way of, number one, glorifying God. And this is what I've noticed. Every time you glorify God, He's going to do something more. He's going to do something again. He's going to do something extra so that you may glorify Him again. You know? That's why I'll tell you, the one that testifies will testify again. That's what happens. I've been in ministry for some time, and I've even noticed it in people. Those that testify are always the ones that will testify again. You know? So, cultivate that heart, that spirit, where you know the Lord has done something. Immediately, you testify and give glory to him. But I also said, number two, that your testimony establishes what God has done for you. And you see, the testimony of this brother is similar to something that I've, something that I have shared several times, that I've ever seen, you know, in meetings, that, let's say the other example I gave you, of this lady that had problems with her legs. And then in the service, as I made, I think, a mass prayer, or I touched them, or I made a mass prayer, she was healed in one of the legs. And I said to testify. And she said, no, but the other leg, there's still pain. But the other leg, the pain has gone. Then she said, okay, I'll still go and testify for the single leg. And she said, as she walked to testify for the single leg, as she walked, then she found the other leg was also healed. You see? And it happens many times. That's what the brother was saying. The pain has reduced. He says, okay, let me go testify that the pain has reduced. Oh, I've been healed, but there's still a little bit pain. As it's going, then all the pain vanishes. That's what happens. Are you there? That's why don't be that person that waits the whole week. Or you wait 2 months. You know, I get a lot of testimonies. I don't know which preachings you have been listening to, but I get a lot of testimonies of, pastor, I got healed 2 months ago, but I was first waiting to see if it is real. Yeah, like I read a lot of them. I was waiting to see if nothing will change. You know what? We are glad nothing has changed. Because what you have done, you did what causes things to change back to where you are coming from. Hallelujah. And we always say that also, the Bible says the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Revelations 19 and verse 10. So your testimony is a prophecy for someone. Within your testimony, there is a spirit of prophecy there. As you testify of what the Lord has done, you know, others will also receive the same. Hallelujah. The Bible shows us that the Bible contains the promises of God. And even the accounts and stories of people in the Bible, those are still his promises to us. As I say, the testimony of Jesus Christ is the spirit of prophecy. So whatever we read in the Bible, whether it was spoken to Elijah, or it was spoken to Abraham, or it happened with Paul, or it happened with Peter, that thing is still a promise to us. And so there are many promises in the Bible. And when the promises of God that are contained in the Bible, when the promises of God are known and then are insisted upon in faith, they will always produce results. You can write that down. When the promises of God are known and insisted upon in faith, they will always produce results. So when you get to know what the Lord said in his word, and then through your faith, by faith, you insist that whatever the word says can and should happen in your life, it will happen in your life, just like it happened in other people's lives. Let's look at a few promises very quickly. Let's start on healing and health. Just very quickly. Healing and health. 3 John chapter number 1 and verse 2. 3 John chapter 1 verse 2. The Bible says, beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper. So God wants you to prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. So the Bible says God wants you to be in health. So you can insist on it and say, Lord, I will not be weak when your word says I should be in health. And you say, I pray and I declare that from today I'm walking in perfect health, in my toes, in my legs, in my stomach, in my chest, my back, my head, my whatever. You can declare it so, because it's a promise of God. Exodus chapter 15 and verse 26. Exodus chapter 15, verse 26, the last part of it, the Bible says, I will put none of these diseases upon thee. I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I brought upon the Egyptians. For I am the Lord that what? Healeth thee. He says, I am the Lord that healeth. Not that healed. That healeth thee. That means he can still heal even today. He is the Lord that healeth. Hallelujah. So it says, none of these diseases should come upon you. It says, none of these diseases will be upon me. In the name of Jesus, I reject any disease according to the word of God. I'll be healthy and strong. Yes. Matthew chapter 8. I'm going to read about Isaiah. Matthew 8 verse 16. Matthew 8 and verse 16. The Bible says, when it was even, as in evening, it says, when the even was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils. And he cast out the spirits with his word. So he spoke the word and demons checked out. That's also a promise that if we speak the word, demons must leave. He says, and he healed all, not some. He healed all. If he healed all, we shouldn't be in a service where some are healed and others go back sick. So don't be there and say and disqualify yourself that maybe the ones that will be healed are those ones. He healed all that were sick. Verse 17. That it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, so there was a promise. What did the promise say? Himself took our infirmities. Himself bare our sicknesses. So Jesus took our infirmities and he bare our sicknesses. If he took our infirmities, that means we don't have them anymore, isn't it? If he took them, that means we don't have them. We don't need to have them. He bare our sicknesses. If he bore our sicknesses, we don't need to have them. You know, a few times that I have said these things like this, you know, I've ever heard some people get offended. They say, but Pastor, you talk like some people are not sick. Let's wait till you get sick one day. And let's see if you talk that way. No. You see, the Bible has not instructed the minister nor anyone else to preach their experiences. We are supposed to primarily preach the Bible and only use our stories and experiences to the extent that they are in line with the Bible. In other words, even if you are sick in your body, it doesn't change the word. That means if you are sick and you insist on the word, that's what will change your situation. Remember, Jesus said, Lazarus is sleeping. They said, no, Lazarus is dead. Jesus said, Lazarus sleepeth. But you see, if you believe that Lazarus sleepeth, that's what will cause Lazarus to wake and it will truly prove that he was sleeping. Are you listening? So you can still declare that himself took our infirmities. So I don't have any infirmities. No. He bare our sicknesses. I am not sick. I cannot be sick. I will never be sick. I am healthy and strong. That can be your declaration. After all, the Bible says, they that dwell in Zion shall not say, I am sick. Acts 10 verse 38. If you have any oppression of the devil, any attack, whatever it is, instead of wasting time to give them names, instead of spending time to give them names that this one is spiritual husband, this one is spiritual uncle, this one is spiritual whatever, this one is from the moon, this one is a spirit of slumber, this one is a spirit of confusion, this one is the spirit that comes and disturbs things that we are working just fine. You know, instead of you giving them names, just know this. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were what? Oppressed of the devil. That means if you're oppressed of the devil, as Jesus healed them, and he is the same yesterday, he is the same today, he is the same forever. Shout glory. So whatever demonic oppression, whatever you have been seeing in your dreams, whatever you have been experiencing on your bed, as you are walking, as you are eating, whatever, any oppression, today it must bow to the name of Jesus. First John chapter 3, verse 8. And do you know that as I'm saying this, you can extend them to your family and your friends. So the same scripture extends to your family and friends. You can also believe God for a miracle for your brother, your sister, if they are experiencing any oppression. First John chapter 3 and verse 8. The Bible says that last part. He says that for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested. He came for this purpose, that he might what? Destroy the works of the devil. That means any work of the devil is destroyed. I know, but it's just certain he's destroyed. What is happening in my family is certain, is destroyed. This must be the devil. Okay, the devil that has been destroyed. Are you there? So don't allow anything that you don't like to remain in your body. Let every other name fade away. Hallelujah. Let's see one or two promises on marriage. Marriage partner, fruit of the womb. And by extension, happy families. Genesis chapter number 2, verse 18. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 18. Are you there? The Bible says, and the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an help meet for him. It is not good that man should be what? Alone. So, you can remain alone if you want. It's fine. But, if you don't want to be alone, you can stand on God's word. I'm not saying you can sell yourself to anyone. But you can stand on God's word. And you say, Lord, according to your word, it is not good for man to be alone. You said, I will make him an help meet for him. So if I am a man, I can stand on this word and say, Lord, where is my helper that you, God, has made for me? Bring him, Lord, just like you brought Eve to Adam. If you are also Eve, you can also insist, Lord, I am someone's helper. What am I doing alone? Not helping someone. Lord, take me to my Adam. You see? So these are promises that you can stand on. Proverbs 18 and verse 22. Proverbs 18 and verse 22. The Bible says, whoso findeth a wife. So that one we have already talked about it. The Bible says, findeth a what? A good thing. Whoso findeth a wife, findeth a good thing, and obtaineth favor of the Lord. So if your wife is being a nuisance, irritating, confusing you, being a disturbance in the home and in your life, you can stand on the scripture today. That, Lord, you said, when I find a wife, I have found a good thing. I have found a wife, not a knife. You know, and you can insist on it. That, Lord, my wife is supposed to be a good wife. The same way, also as a wife, you can also pray to God on the same. And say, Lord, I'm supposed to be a good wife with a good man, a good husband. And you pray that, Lord, may my husband be good. If your husband is ill-treating you, if your husband is careless, if your husband is a womanizer, if your husband is doing all these funny, unacceptable things, you can stand on God's word and say, Lord, I expect my husband to be a good husband, just like he has found a good wife. You see? Psalm number 127, verse 3, on children. Psalm 127, verse 3. The Bible says, Lo, children are an heritage of the Lord. Children are an inheritance from the Lord. And the Bible says, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. His reward to his children. So you can stand on it and say, Lord, thank you. That children are an inheritance from you. I stand on your word, O God, to receive my inheritance, to receive my reward. In the name of Jesus. You are a lady. You say, I will become pregnant this month of June. You are a married woman. I will become pregnant this month of June. You are a man. You say, my wife is becoming pregnant. I'm saying, my wife, eh? Not I'm impregnating someone somewhere. That is now sin. And the promise for sin is death. My wife is becoming pregnant this month of June. You can stand on God's word like that. Hallelujah. Psalm 113, verse 9, the Bible says, he maketh a barren woman to keep a house and to be a joyful mother of children. Praise ye the Lord. So God can change the barren woman to become a joyful mother, not of a child, but of what? Children. Hallelujah. Finances. Your finances. If you have been struggling financially, you can stand on the promises of God as regards your finances. We have already looked at 3 John chapter 1 verse 2 that he desires above all things that you should prosper. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 9. The Bible says, for ye know the grace. Let's read together. One, two, go. For ye know, hold on, let's start again. One, two, go. For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. So there is no place for being poor. There is no place for financial struggles. Ah, no, pastor, but it's a economy. No, doesn't matter. Economy, I will not be poor. Economy, I will not be broke. Are you listening? That must be your prayer. Psalm number 25 and verse 12. Psalm 25 and verse 12. I think put it in the NIV. Psalm 25 and verse 12. The Bible says, who then is the man that fears the Lord? Do I have people here that fear the Lord? Who then is the man that fears the Lord? The Bible says, he, that means God, will instruct him in the way chosen for him. Verse 13. He will, read it with me, one to go. The Bible says he will spend his days in what? Prosperity. So say with me, I will spend my days in prosperity. Say it again, I will spend my days in prosperity. Yes. So there's no room for spending your days in financial struggles. If you are struggling financially, you can insist on it in prayer. From the depths of your heart, you say, Lord, things are changing. In the name of Jesus, things are changing. And you pray and you declare. And he says, and his descendants, that means his children, and by extension, anything that comes out of you will inherit the land. Finally, Genesis 26. Genesis 26 and verse 13. There are many. We could have even looked at Psalm 75, verse 6, 7, that promotion does not come from the east or from the west. But let's look at Genesis 26, verse 13, from the Message Translation. From the Message Translation, verse 13 of Genesis 26, the Bible says, the man, he says, the man got what? Richer and richer by the day until he was very wealthy. The man got richer and richer. Hey, what a promise. Richer and what? Richer. Not rich, full stop. He got richer and richer by the day until he was very wealthy. He accumulated flocks and herds and many, many servants. So much so that the Philistines began to envy him. So you must become so stinking rich until people begin to envy you. Become so rich until people begin to envy you. Hallelujah. I said you must become so rich until people begin to what? To envy you. Tell neighbor, say neighbor. Become so rich until people begin to envy you. Again, become so rich until people begin to envy you. In Jesus' name. Finally, last but not the least, and it's not an exhaustive list, is encounters. You know, I have told you, okay, let's give the verse, Acts chapter number 2. I have told you that an encounter is a supernatural experience with God. Simply that, an encounter is a supernatural experience with God. It could be examples could be the power of God comes upon you. It could be you are caught in the spirit or in a trance. It could be you are hearing the voice of God. The Lord speaking to you is also an encounter. Seeing visions is an encounter. Seeing angels, seeing Jesus, or whatever the Lord does to you, whatever the Lord shows you, whatever you feel, all of those are encounters. And I've always told you that encounters have got so many benefits. Some of them are that an encounter helps you to know that God is real. And that's very important, to know that God is real. And in every other time you encounter him, it is a reassurance that God is real and he is with you. Very, very important. An encounter also makes you to know that God is big. And is bigger than any situation, bigger than any challenge, bigger than anything. An encounter also strengthens your convictions. It strengthens your convictions for Jesus Christ. It strengthens your convictions that Jesus is coming again. It strengthens your convictions that you must preach the gospel. It strengthens your convictions that faith works, prayer works, declaration works, giving works, and all of these things work. It strengthens your convictions. It also strengthens your faith. And an encounter also gives birth to spiritual hunger. An encounter gives birth or increases spiritual hunger or spiritual thirst. What you'd say, it helps you to have a fresh fire. It also stirs you up to fulfill destiny and to save God. An encounter also increases your fear for the Lord or your reverence for God. An encounter helps you to increase in your fear of the Lord or your reverence for God. Many times, compromises that people do, where today they are sinning, tomorrow they are saying, but Lord, forgive me. And then the other day they sin again and they are still wondering, why isn't it that I cannot stop sinning? You need an encounter, my friend. An encounter, one encounter will cause you to know that the Lord is great, the Lord is mighty, the Lord is a consuming fire. And from that reverence of God, it will help you to change your life. It even helps you to love God. So many things that an encounter does. Let's read about one of it. I said in Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2 and verse 1. The Bible says, and suddenly, okay, from verse 1. The Bible says, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven. You see, that's already an encounter. Just to be in a place and you hear a sound from heaven, that's already an experience. There came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And the Bible says that, and it filled all the house where they were sitting, like a wind filled the house. That is already an experience, an encounter. Verse 3. And there appeared unto them. The fact that something appeared is already an experience. What appeared? Cloven tongues like as of fire. So some little fires appeared. He says, and those fires sat upon each one of them. They sat upon each one of them. All of these are encounters, experiences. And in verse number 4, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. That's an experience. And they began to speak with other tongues. That's an experience, an encounter. As the Spirit gave them utterance, that's an encounter. If you're going to be speaking something that the Holy Spirit is giving you to say, to declare, that's an encounter. And I would want us that, you know, when we are taking testimonies, we must always add testimonies of an encounter. If you get some strong encounter, maybe something you have never experienced, something that you really want to share, you should be able to share it with us. Just the same way that people share on healing or finances or anything. Are you there? Are you ready to pray? Masante lekato lakato jalabas leketo lakatele kato jalabas. A definite encounter, oh God. A definite encounter, oh God. Clones abante to jalates. Clones alakatele kotolatas. Monja lakatele vozolates. Masonja. Clones atonja lakons alates. Masonja tes. Clones abante. Le consalates, mason jatis, consabante le consalabas, la catelecoto, mantelecatelecoto labas, la caton jalabas.